So I've told people it's a three-part process to forgiveness. Okay. So when we forgive, which is a mandate in the Word, but when we forgive, we need to say, Father, I ask you to forgive me. I repent for taking in the hurt, for taking in the wound, because I took it in. Now, it may have been something that absolutely was horrific. Abuse, you know, molestation, rape. And people think, I have a right to be angry. Well, no, you don't.
That's right.
Because Jesus lives in you, and he took all that.
That's right.
Amen.
So we have to repent for taking that in. But the next thing is, say, I choose to forgive this person. Not because they're going to get off scot-free.
That's right.
Because it says right here, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. But I choose to no longer allow them to rent space in my head. That I choose to no longer let that control me. And so I choose to forgive. Father, I forgive them. And I release them from any debt that they owe me. That's the third part. That you release them. Just a second. Because when you release them, it not only releases them, whether they say they're sorry or not, whether they see it or not, it doesn't matter. You're doing an act of your will before you and God. I release them from that debt. It frees you. But guess what? By you holding it, you've actually bound them. Just get over here so y'all can see. You have actually bound them. And when you say, God, I release them from any debt that they owe me, that comes up. And then God can deal with them.
That's right. Amen.
So you release you and you release them. And it is so powerful, we don't even understand how powerful it is. Hold on, just Joanne. Sonia, you were had your hand up, and I'll get to you in just a second.
I just wanted to bring up also
worldly music.
Absolutely.
How it affects your spirit.
It does.
Yeah.
Takes you back to where you were at, you know, and it, I know, it goes on in my house, so I know, you know, and you have to fight those old feelings because everything comes back, so we have to watch.
That's right.
Even the music.
You were just reminded me, you know, music is so much a part of me. When I was growing up, kids were outside playing. Keri, me, I was sitting in front of the old console stereo, singing to records. That's what I was doing. Mom and Dad have a video of me when I was, what, maybe seven? Standing on the fireplace with a hairbrush, singing. But I have to watch myself because sometimes I will still get into some of that music. Sometimes I'll think, I can listen to a song or two. And I love it. Disco kind of thing was my era, the R&B. And yet, I can tell it changes the atmosphere. And I have to really watch it. When I went to be with my kids for Christmas time, my daughter, I was really surprised. She starts putting on a playlist. And I mean, Terry and I, we would play things like America, you know, that, been to the desert and the high horse with no name. It felt good to be out of the rain. Anyway, all these different things. And, so my kids kind of had a mixture of music and stuff. And I used to also play Anita Baker, if anybody knows Anita Baker.
Yeah.
In fact, my son informed me that I had a CD that I'd made, and he threw it out the window. Anyway. So, but anyways, when I went back at Christmas, because she said, I got a playlist for us to listen to when we take our road trip to go see Spencer. And so she starts playing it, and it's like the 60s, 70s, and 80s stuff. And I start singing this one song, and she goes, you know that song? And I said, and you know it?
You
know, no, a lot of those songs might be innocent,
and also
but
the,
it's what's behind it.
A lot of the artists were into witchcraft.
Or drugs.
Absolutely.
Because I went to a meeting with Little Richard.
Ooh.
Yeah,
yeah.
And when he got converted, and he was saying how they go and they put taxes on their music.
Oh,
wow. So
yes.
That you can get into you.
Wow.
Absolutely.
And you can't forget the song. You can't get it out of
yes.
You
yes.
Because of what they put into it.
Wow.
And they made millions, you know, doing this because they're going to be successful.
Wow.
Yeah.
So that's what he was saying. A lot of the,
they've traded their souls for
exactly.
Their own.
Exactly.
And
that's why the music has such an effect.
Yes.
Because
absolutely.
Of what they put into it.
I haven't forgotten you, but I do want to say one thing. I've studied a lot about this, and I used to have these videos, and I showed all my kids this, but bring that back. It was called They Sold Their Souls for Rock and Roll. And this Christian pastor, he went deep into this stuff, and things like Queen, the song Another One Bites the Dust, Backmasked, it says, start to smoke marijuana. And so that's getting into your subconscious. It's getting into your mind.
Subliminal messages.
Hotel California. The Eagles. I'm telling you, that was one of my favorite groups. Still like them. I don't listen to them. I still like them. But their album cover is a picture of a Spanish mission in the window. Who was sitting there?
Yeah.
Aleister Crowley.
Yeah.
Who wrote the Book of Satan, I believe.
Right.
Wow.
Or it was either him or Anton LaVey. But anyways.
Well,
so you look at these kind of things and the impact that it has on us and so many other things. So many even disco songs or the R&B is so sexual.
Yeah.
It spirits of lust, I mean, and you just have to really watch it. Okay, go ahead. No, go ahead.
I got two things. One is you were talking about forgiveness. We also have to forgive God.
Yes.
Because a lot of times we think, you know, God, where were you in this situation?
Yes, absolutely.
And we need to forgive God also. And I about the music, sometimes, not really all the time, music will take us back to places.
Yes, it will.
Of things that happen that we need to let go of. So we really have to be careful with the music that we listen to.
Absolutely.
I was told this once and didn't take it to heart, but I do now. On unforgiveness, if you are so busy holding in your unforgiveness, then your hands are not free to accept God's blessings.
Yes, that's true.
So true.
Because it's what you're concentrating on. So, okay. I am running out of time, y'all. So, did you have a comment?
It goes even deeper than that. It's we've got to be careful even what we're reading.
Exactly.
Yeah.
What we watch.
What we watch. What we watch our kids. I know that the hardest thing for me to understand is how Christians can justify Harry Potter.
Oh, boy.
And
exactly.
and the Vampire Diaries and
yes.
All that other stuff, and I just don't get it.
Absolutely.
And so I mean, there's even some books out there that if you're not real careful. You can read the back of the cover and it'll sound so good that it's all God, but it's not the God that we
absolutely.
Need to be reading.
Absolutely. So we have to watch all these things. So I'm just going to go through real quick. We have trauma. Just give a couple examples. Major type of illness, sudden death of a loved one or something, sudden loss of jobs. It can open the door for spirits of fear, rejection, depression, and more. Go ahead.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Do I say it all the time when I've had a particularly hard day. I'll wash my hands with it, go to bed, and have my hands by my face and say, I miss you, Grandma. And I don't know. Am I then crossing some kind of line? I don't feel like I'm talking to my grandmother. I'm just saying, I miss you, Grandma.
Well, I think that's where you have to be really careful as far as having a false affection, where we use something or have something in our life that takes the place of God. God wants us to put Him in that place and not anyone or anything else. So you're bringing that on as comfort, but the Holy Spirit is our comfort. And so it would be trading. See, I did the same thing with smoking. I smoked for 27 years. And I asked the Lord to show me what part in my heart it was filling, because I couldn't shake free from it. And finally, the Lord showed me, and I know it sounds stupid, but He said, you believe that that cigarette will never leave you. And you believe that it will never leave me, and that I can count on it. Because it comes down to control.
Yeah.
Because I could buy it, I could keep it, whatever. And so the Lord, when I finally was able to quit, the Lord showed me, you put that ahead of me. It was the last thing I did at night, first thing I did in the morning. If I woke up in the middle of the night, I wouldn't smoke. I'd be smoking and praying. I was in ministry and smoking. And I would have my good friend and pastor and counselor that I worked with, he'd say, come out of her in the name of Jesus. And I'd say, you're absolutely right, because I knew. But I was under that curse. And until the Lord showed me that I had made it an idol and I could repent, then I was able to be set free from that. Go ahead, Lisa.
My dad passed away in November, and my sister sent me a necklace with his ashes in it. And I'm sorry. I just didn't. I just felt like it was like...
Yeah, keeping it alive, really.
Yeah. So, what do you do?
I think for something like that, in my opinion, somebody might want to speak on this. I think it's what you do with it.
Yeah.
I think that if you say, oh, that's nice, unless the Holy Spirit reveals to you that there's some kind of soul tie there, I would just say, okay, that's nice, and put it away. It's a remembrance.
I just put it in the glory box.
Now, somebody else may have another opinion on that, but I believe it has to do with what you make of it and where you put it. Yes, you're right. It could be a doorway. And
well,
definitely seek the Holy Spirit on that.
My thing is, if it's going to give legal right to the enemy, I'd rather
whatever it might be, if it's going to give the enemy legal right, I'd rather just put it away, throw it away, smash it, do whatever, and keep the pathway clear for the Lord.
Absolutely. Right. Absolutely. That's why I'm saying, seek the Holy Spirit. Because I don't want to go on an opinion. I don't want to go on somebody having a fresh grief of something. But seek the Holy Spirit, for sure.
Hello. Wednesday night, we were talking about cremation. And, you know, both my folks are cremated. My son is cremated. My Michael's cremated. My daughter, I don't have her ashes. My brother's cremated. I have all of those ashes. I have urns for them. And I just, you know, have them in my condo. Now, I don't romance them. I don't rub the urns. I don't talk to them.
Yes.
I don't. They're just in my mind.
Yes.
So is that, should I not keep them? Are you saying I shouldn't keep them?
You know what? Again, I'm talking for me.
Yes.
I don't
yes.
want to give the enemy
yes.
this much room.
Right.
In
seek
my life.
The Holy Spirit.
So, yeah.
Okay.
It doesn't sound like you're worshiping them.
No,
you're not talking to them.
Let me tell you something.
But
those urns
if there's
were
a doorway,
expensive.
Yes, they
were expensive.
And the Holy Spirit is faithful. He will show you. If there's a open doorway, that's the key. You know, Holy Spirit, is there any legal right? Is there any open doorway through these things?
Because I don't even.
Yeah, because there can be, just like she was saying about the necklace, inanimate objects.
Right.
Even buildings, you know, there can be things there, and so we do want to see. Holy Spirit, show me where there's legal.
I had one of my son's friends who was living with us for a while, and I didn't know she had her father's ashes. And I asked her what her father was like, and I said, I never really got to talk to her. Well, she had his ashes, and all of a sudden, anger came on me. I could not get it off me. And I asked her, I said, did your father have anger issues? No. I said, well, what was your relationship like? Well, he used to put me down because I was heavy. He used to abuse my brother. I said, those ashes, I'm sorry. Wherever you put them, you gotta put them, they gotta get out of my house.
Yeah.
And believe it or not, my father believes in Jesus, but this is towards the end, but he converted, you know, I led him to the Lord. And the Lord was actually speaking through him, prophesying to me, telling me to let that anger go, and blah, blah, blah. Yeah, so he helped me to release it, but it was bad. I mean, bad. I wanted to just walk up to people and just punch them in the face and almost said, oh, and that's not me at all.
Yeah.
I'll give you the shirt off my back, give you my last, I'll give anything and everything for you.
Yeah.
So I knew.
Well, and that's what we're saying,
bad,
an open doorway for the enemy.
On any of these things, the question is, how do you feel about giving it up? If you cannot give it up, you have made it something more than what it needs to be.
Yeah, that's good.
And that's whether it's a piece of jewelry, or let's say that a pastor comes from Africa, brings me an elephant made by somebody, or you go to some store here and pick up something that was made in India. Things like that. It may have an attachment to an evil God, that's true. But can you give up what you treasure? In your case, Kathleen, can you give up those urns? Can you give up the jewelry? See, things like that. So if you have an inordinate attachment to something, you need to bring it into order. That's all.
And the same thing, just like you were talking, Lydia, if it's something that you can't give up because it is, you might say, it's the only thing that I have. It's the only thing that brings me comfort. It's the only thing I do for me if it's an activity. That's where you've put that in place of God. And it's become an idol. So.
I think that's where it comes down to our relationship with the Lord and the Holy Spirit, and being so sensitive to hear His voice, and know beyond a shadow of a doubt that it's Him.
Yes.
And sometimes, I mean, I'm wearing my mom's sweater, and it's like, you know, part of me was like, oh, get rid of it. But it gets to the point where the Holy Spirit will reveal to you at the right time.
Yes.
When He knows that you are capable and you are willing to let it go and to deal with it. Because I think sometimes we make a mistake that we get rid of things so quickly, then we regret it later, and then that opens another door. Mm-hmm. Holy Spirit is ever so gentle that when we are at that point where He knows that He can speak to us and we will be obedient to do it, it will happen. Because if we do it in our emotions, and if we do it and we go based on what other people are saying, then that I believe that sometimes opens the door itself to other things that we shouldn't have been. But I know with myself, the Holy Spirit is walking me through a journey, and when I'll come across something in my closet, I'll say, it's time.
Yes.
Be intentional. Get
yes.
rid of it. It's time. And then there's no emotions wrapped with it. There's nothing else that goes along with it. There's no regret. There's a freedom. There's a like, okay, thank you. And it just is so easy to do, and it's not, and I feel like it closes the door.
Yes, absolutely.
And it doesn't give Satan a legal right. But if I do it with my emotions and stuff, then I am opening up the door to all sorts of other things. That's me personally.
No, but that's true.
Because he will heal the heart.
Yes.
He will heal that thing that's got you attached
right.
to it.
Right. It's that event in the heart that wants you to keep holding on to those things. Because those things really don't mean anything.
They don't mean anything.
But it's what's in the heart.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, Don. Oh, you sure? Okay. Jane, you had a question?
I'd like to say something about idols. These cell phones today, they are such an idol. You can't even go into a restaurant.
People aren't talking anymore.
I mean, they were invented to, you know, call somebody, not sit and play with them all the time. And I wish people would stop.
Hey, I'm guilty
of
that.
Roses.
Yeah. Well, it's replaced relationship.
Yeah, it has.
And it's replaced relationship not only with us, but even God.
Yes.
You know?
That's why these millennials are not learning proper
self-love,
social
right.
skills, courtesy,
exactly.
Exactly. Respect. They're not learning proper
relationships. No relationship. Yeah. Absolutely. All right, well, I'm going to make this quick, and I'm not going to go through a lot of stuff because we have limited time, so... we talked about trauma, abuse, verbal, physical, sexual, ungodly soul ties. This can come through abuse, it can come through any sexual tie, codependency, control, manipulation, situations. Ungodly soul ties, you know, it can even come through dependency on things, whatever. Curses, of course, we've talked about that. There's direct curses, like witchcraft, Satanism, self-cursing. We are all pretty much guilty of that. Talking down to ourselves, saying, I hate that about me. We're cursing ourselves. You know, or I don't like this about my body, or I don't like the way I do that. All these curses. General curses, like cutting remarks, like when somebody says, you'll never amount to anything, no one will ever love you, that kind of thing. Those are speaking curses over you. I remember when I, as a single parent, when I was first in college down here, I went to a vocational school, and I started out in interior design. And the teacher, she said, you'll never make it. Well, I thought I was doing pretty good, but but when she said that, my self-esteem was so low that I bought into that lie.
Yeah.
I bought into it. I came into agreement with that. And so, she was not right. So, addictions, chemically or behavioral based, such as alcohol, cocaine, heroin, meth, marijuana, LSD, anti-drugs, prescription drugs, anorexia, bulimia, gluttony. Fears and phobias, abnormal or irrational fears, like if somebody's scared of driving or scared to go swimming, you know, things like that. False religions, teaching that goes against only one way to God the Father and His kingdom of heaven through Jesus Christ. Even more. So, thank goodness our Savior Jesus Christ comes to our rescue. Here's another scripture, Isaiah 53, 4 through 6. Isaiah 53, 4 through 6 says, surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that made us whole, and with his stripes we are healed. Not that we will be healed.
We are.
We have already been healed.
Sometimes
we were. Yes, we were healed. So it's already been done on the cross. So, and it says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. That's why when the enemy has legal right, it's the blood of Jesus that takes away his legal right. When we repent and we say, I nail that to the cross, I apply the blood of Jesus. Father, I repent and I thank you that you see me through the blood of Jesus, because his blood speaks that better word for me. So, okay, iniquities in our generational bloodlines, there's four life-changing consequences. Again, iniquities are a bending, twisting, or distorting the law or God's word. It gives the enemy legal right to tempt us. They mold and shape our identity through sickness, mindsets, and beliefs. And I know I'm going fast. I apologize. They detour us from our destiny. They cause us to go off the correct path that God has laid out for us. And the devil uses the iniquities to build a legal case against us. So the major key to undoing these bloodline iniquities and curses, when Jesus died on the cross, it was the greatest legal transaction in history. It was a verdict rendered against the devil, and that was done on the cross.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. However, a verdict that has not been executed has no power. We must go into the courts of heaven and repent on behalf of the bloodline, the curses, you know, what we've been saying as the Holy Spirit reveals things. This is how we as believers carry out the legalities that Jesus shed blood, put in place when he died on the cross and took all of the sin in the world. So Robert Henderson explains it this way. You see, when Jesus died on the cross, he legally provided atonement for all of mankind. This is spoken of in 2 Corinthians 5, 18 and 19. Says God reconciled himself back to the world legally. Every legal issue that separated God and man was taken out of the way through the cross. And because of what Jesus did for us on the cross, God can now legally forgive and cleanse us when we meet the legal requirement of confession and repentance. We are, in essence, executing what Jesus legally purchased for us, our freedom. He bought us with a price. Go ahead.
I just want to say another word, a way to look at that word atonement is at one moment.
Yes, I like that. Yeah. Let me write that down. At one moment. It's good.
Now one with God.
Gives you something, and then you think, well, I don't really know if I should say something, and then it just doesn't let up. That's what happened. It didn't let up, and so that happened last night, but I need to say this, and then today came, it's like, I need to say this, but I didn't. And then it keeps coming up, and so it's like, I can't leave without saying this. So, Pastor Jim, could you just, this is going to be real quick. Pastor Jim, would you stand here? And Pastor Jim is going to be God. And here's, this was what was on. I just have to give you this analogy because I think it's going to sum up a lot. So this was what I was. This is all the things that I did in my sin, right? And this is Jesus. And so then when I accepted Jesus into my heart, and the blood of Jesus washed this away, and it became clear. So he sees me as absolutely nothing. I have no sin. This is the part that we could be doing that we don't want to be doing. So it's already finished. It's the finished work of the cross. It's already what Jesus did. But I'm feeling so bad and so guilty and can't receive what he did. And God says, I don't see it. I don't see it, Donna. Look, you're clear. Yeah, but that's not the truth. I'm bypassing. This is important. Don't bypass what he's done. It's so big. And when you really... really watch that video, and you could really see the whole thing and what Jesus did. Don't take it lightly. Don't think that you what you've done has been is so much bigger than what Jesus did on the cross.
Right.
He did it all. Every single sin that you could ever do, past, present, and future. So when you decide that you think that you're still guilty and you're still feeling bad about all this stuff, this is exactly what you're doing. You're bypassing him like he never even did it. Saying, no, that wasn't enough what you did. And so, God, I got to tell you something. He might have died for me and for my sins, but I really need you to know this. I really am this. I am really this. I am really this. And I'm really this. And there it is, back on here. You put it back on yourself.
Yes.
It's what you put it back on yourself.
Right.
And he can't do anything about that now, because what did you do now? What separates you from God? It's your sin. You put it back on there. So now you want this relationship with the Lord. This is what's in between you. You can't embrace him. All right, so now we're going to go back to this. You repent again. Jesus, I go back to Jesus. I didn't realize. I can't believe that. What you did, I'm so grateful for what you did for me. And I didn't take it wholeheartedly. I just didn't realize. I'm still stuck in my stuff. I'm so sorry.
Yes.
Now you go back. It's back to this. Now you don't have this separating, this sin separating you. When there's a separation like this between me and God, don't forget this is God. It's not Pastor Jim. If this, I can't get heart to heart with him. Because there's something in between
us.
And it's us and our thoughts. And so when that's not there, is it right if I touch him? I really want you to be God. So he's going to open up his arms. There's nothing in between us anymore. And this is what it feels like.
Mm-hmm.
You are heart to heart. There's nothing of your stuff there
Thank
anymore.
You, Lord. Thank you, Lord. That's awesome. Yes. So cleansing our generational bloodline is a strategic way to silence the accuser of the brethren, canceling any case against us. We must understand that the blood of Jesus is a powerful weapon that stands as evidence of atonement for our sins and those committed by our forefathers in the past. So this is good. The blood of Jesus is not something that has spoken. It is something that is still speaking. It doesn't stop, it continues. So because of the blood of Jesus and his word, we have access to God the Father and information about God and his kingdom as it applies to us. I do apologize for going so fast, but I know we don't have much time. So we enter the courts to come back into godly order. Okay? Where maybe we've gotten off course or our family line. Satan wants to block all the abundant blessings that God has in store for us and others in the body of Christ today. He brings cases against believers to block us from coming into alignment with the destiny God has set for us. And when we go and repent, we have authority to enter into the courts of heaven and render a verdict in our favor through our repentance. But it's only because of the blood of Jesus. It is nothing that we've done. It is the blood. The blood is the only way that receives our repentance and wipes it out. So nothing else does. It's not our works. So. So I've already said this. Make repentance our friend. So we want to enter the courts by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and that they did not love their lives to the death. That's they who overcame, and that's us. So what is released from the courts of heaven when we repent and we come out of agreement? Well, we get breakthroughs and answered prayer. Inheritance and authority. Destiny and anointing. Go ahead. Yes, that's what's released when we go into the courts of heaven. Breakthroughs and answered prayer, inheritance and authority, destiny and anointing. Go ahead.
Okay. This word sin, we have made such a horrible thing. Sometimes we don't think that we can come out of it. But really, in Hebrew, the word is mark. We're missing the mark.
Yes.
And what is the
mark?
The mark really is the word. We're missing the mark of walking out the word. And all we have to do is get back on the mark.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, and it by the blood of Jesus. But it's just missing the mark. There is, this sin is not so horrible. Sometimes it's hard for us to go to the Lord because we think we're such a horrible person for what we've done. But we've only,
yes.
And it's not great, but we've just missed the mark.
Yes.
That's all we've done. And
yes.
The mark is the word.
And that's what I'm saying too, by coming back into godly order. Where we missed the mark, we're coming back.
Yes.
God's restoring us back. And so,
I'm sorry. But that word mark is not as hard and overwhelming
or judgmental.
Or judgmental as that word
absolutely.
Sin. Because even in Hebrew, that word judgment is deliverance.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Okay.
So when we get a verdict, a judgment is pronounced, we have deliverance. So we do this by confessing, repenting, forgiving, and accessing the blood of Jesus. All right, so the blood of Jesus gives us authority. It's time we come together as the body of Christ to decree and declare his promises in the courts of heaven. Your breakthrough and answered prayers are waiting. God has a divine plan for you. Let it be done on earth as it is in heaven. So, now, I was going to tell you a little bit more about my story. We're running close on time, and so... I want us to pray a general prayer together. And if anybody wants to have any personal prayer, you want to get deeper or whatever, feel free to come up and let's pray. Okay. So I just want to be mindful of our time. So, I left you on that cliffhanger last night about my family. I'm happy to tell you so much more. I will tell you one thing real quick. When I was talking about my son that went to live with his girlfriend, and the Lord told me that I had to pray, but I had to pray and pray him out, call him back out. So as I was listening to all this stuff, all this teaching and stuff, we had a conference at the other building back. I thought it was August, but I had written it down, and it was September. It was actually September 22nd that I had this dream. So I'm going to read this to you. So I was sitting in my room at night. The lights were on. All of a sudden, I saw clouds come in through the windows. So I guess the windows were open. I thought, what in the world is this? I remember making it a, it made an impression on me that there was no odor. And I remember in up in Boone, we actually, because we were in the mountains, I would see fog come through the window, actually, if we had our windows open. So I knew it wasn't really anything strange. But I thought, what's going on? So I got up to touch it and to see if it was clouds, and it became a net and fell over me. It was trapping me. I then looked, and I saw a man standing outside in the yard. He had a royal blue t-shirt on, and his hair, he had a hair net on, and he was pulling on the net. It was so vivid. There was also a white van parked at the corner. I was fighting against it and started yelling, help. But my help was, help, help. Suddenly, I turned to look at the door and I was saying, help. Suddenly, I turned back to where I saw him out the window. And all of a sudden, he was right there in my face. And he was trying to grab me. And all I could think of at the time was, like, human trafficking. It was just very strange. So I turned to look at the door again. And this time, my help was much louder. Help! Help! Suddenly, my brother, Adam, he overheard me yelling for help, and he opened the door. When he opened the door, he was shocked to see a man in my room and started pushing on his face. He actually went, and he went over. This was all in my dream. He went over, and he took his hand like this and hit his face and pushed him away from me. Yelled help again, and this time it was audible, and I woke myself up. In fact, you may not remember this, but you opened the door to see if I was okay, and I said, yeah, I had a nightmare. I had a dream. I had no idea what that was. I thought, what in the world? Because it was so vivid. It was like, it was just so real. So after that, God showed me through teaching with Robert Henderson that whatever prophecies, visions, dreams, or pictures we've been given about our lives, children, and more, if they haven't been fulfilled, to declare and decree them over the people and situation. So I went to the courts of heaven, and I started declaring and decreeing. And now, when I first started this, I didn't know what I was doing. All I did was say, Father, I really don't know what I'm doing, but I come to the courts of heaven. You as my judge. So then I remember at the time I was going through some issues with rejection in my heart, and the Holy Spirit was so faithful where I began to see it. Ooh, don't take in rejection. I could see it playing out in so many different areas of my life because I had been so used to it. And I remember Mom was working on accounting or something. Hope you don't mind me telling this. But we were sitting there, and she was talking to me about my son Spencer and his girlfriend Tony, and said, well, you know, this has been going on for a while. And I said, yeah, because he actually kept it hidden for about 4 years. And then all of a sudden, he came and told us about it, and I found out this past Christmas that he met her online on an app called Hot or Not. A lot of teens are into that. And so I thought, wow. But we were talking about that, and Mom, this is in no way to throw you under the bus at all, but it's what happened. Mom looked at her watch, and I thought, she doesn't have time for me. She doesn't have time for me to talk to me. and I felt that rejection come on me. It wasn't on me, but I could feel it coming. And I said, nope, I'm not going to take that on. And I started crying. And I told her, rejection just tried to come on me with that. And as soon as I said that, God took me back. Like my timeline took me back to when I first went to college when I was 18. I was going to Bible college. And I want to say we're going to run a little bit late. So if anybody has to go, I do apologize. And I'll be happy to follow up with you another time. But I just want you to have that freedom, okay? But if it's okay, I'm going to go a little bit more. And I want us to pray. But, so God took me back in my mind. I mean, it was a split second. When I was at, it was called Southwestern Assemblies of God College in Waxahachie, Texas. It's the sister college of Southeastern here. And, so when I first went to college there, it was the first time I'd ever been away from home. I lived in the dorm there. And there was a guy who, the guys' dorm was on this side, the girls' was on this side. There was a lobby and meeting place, whatever, in the middle. And this guy, who knew a friend of mine, he showed up in the lobby, and I had gone down there for something. Well, he asked her about me, wanted to know who I was. And so she commented, hey, this guy wants you to go on a ride with us. And I didn't really think anything about it. I said, okay. So, and then he started coming around a lot, and he liked me, and he asked me what was my favorite car at the time. This was 1982. At that time, my favorite car was a Trans Am. It was the big thing, you know, Trans Am. And so I remember going home for Thanksgiving holiday, and we were in Mobile, Alabama. And I came back, and I see this brand new white Trans Am driving in the parking lot with T-tops. And I remember saying, man, who is that? And because it was a cool car. So I go up to my room, and all of a sudden I hear my name being called over the loudspeaker for me to go down to the lobby, that someone was there for me. And I go down there, and it was this guy. His name was Keri, K-E-R-R-Y. Mine's K-E-R-I. And I was like, hey, you know, what's going on? And he held some keys up in front of me. And I said, well, what's this? And he said, it's yours whenever you want it. And he was driving that Trans Am. From then on, he would bring me anything and everything I wanted, really. He would bring me all these things. And I sucked it up, soaked it up. And I started believing that when somebody brings you things, gives you things, that it must be love. It's very silly and stupid. Amazingly, we believe things like that. So, he ended up asking me to marry him. And during the time that I was spending with him, I was getting further and further away from God. And got into rebellion. And he asked me to marry him. And I convinced myself that I must be in love with him. And so when I went home for Christmas, of course I told Mom and Dad that I was going to marry him, and they were not having any of it. Knew that that was against God, against the plans and purposes God had for me. I already had things in my heart, rejection in my heart because of believing lies, rebellion in my heart. And so I, of course, thought, well, they're just trying to keep me from happiness. And more. So, of course, Dad contacts like every pastor around to say, if my daughter comes, do not marry them.
Good dad.
However, we ended up going to like a Lutheran church or something that didn't know my dad. And I married him. So, what the Lord showed me is that that was a seducing spirit.
Yeah.
That made everything look good. But it had an agenda behind it to kill, steal, and destroy my life.
Wow.
So in that moment, back to where I'm sitting in front of Mom, and I said, I'm not going to take in that rejection. The Lord takes me back in my mind to that time. He said, this is what's happening to Spencer. It's a seducing spirit through his girlfriend and her family that makes it look like it's so good. He wants to teach him how to weld. He wants to teach him all these things. That's what my son brought up to me. He wants to be like a father to him. And Laura was saying, they're reeling him in to kill, steal, and destroy. And then the Lord said, and that's also what happened to Brandon, my older son. When he first married his first wife, Ashley, there were some situations there. She was in the hospital, and he was there. Her family saw that he cared about her, and they began to take him in like he was part of their family. And so the Lord showed me, this seducing spirit is trying to woo you in the, under the guise of family. Because, see, remember, we're all walking around as orphans. With no father, really. Because even though I had a father, I was in rebellion. I didn't receive it. And I believed that I was rejected. And what the Lord began to show me was, you believe that lie, but really, he was just trying to protect you. Just like you're trying to protect your kids.
Yeah.
So, and actually, I had met with Donna, and we got to that conclusion because I was like, I need to know where the root of this is so I can be free. Where's the root of this rejection? And it had to do with rebellion. And then that opened the door for the lying spirit, the unloving spirit that skewed all my decision making for the rest of my life. Until now. Because it's all exposed. It's no longer in darkness. So, when the Lord showed me that, I was like, whoa, oh my gosh. So I knew the Lord was giving me a key to go to the courts of heaven to repent for where I allowed the rebellion in my heart to open the doors for the enemy to bring that seducing spirit that was affecting me and my kids. And so as I then I had to repent to my mom and dad. And what the Lord began showing me as I repented and you read Chile is not a good place to be crying and repenting.
I got that chocolate cake, man.
And how that it touched, it did something, it unlocked something. I could see it in Dad. Because I had held such animosity and hurt and all this rejection and stuff. I believed all the lies. And what it did is it not only bound me, but it bound him, and it bound my whole family.
Yeah.
And I had to get to the place, coming down here, where I could see it and receive it. That day, on my way to meet with Donna, this is where this has come in. That day, I said, Father, I don't care if something's weird, strange, if I just help me to receive everything you have for me. And I remember in the car saying, today changes everything. And it did. So what the Lord showed me was as I started going to the courts of heaven and repenting, the Lord would, Holy Spirit was bringing stuff after stuff after stuff, and I would be like, okay, you know, let me do this, and but I started seeing freedom, and I was like, whoa, and the separation, the relational breakdown, and stuff, I'm so sorry, it was getting better. They were being drawn to me. I also noticed that as I was dealing with one thing, the enemy, well, as I was repenting, it was unlocking things that had been in the dark. Let me say that. So my repentance unlocked things. Now that was not fun because it came against me. Okay, other offenses from son. It was very hurtful. But I knew, even though I was in hurt, I knew that the Lord was saying, now it's out of darkness, so you know how to pray. You know how to go to the courts. And so I was like, okay. And so with my repenting, as far as me and my siblings and my family, I knew that the Lord was telling me. It unlocked, because I knew that when we get hurt and wounded, we close part of our hurt off. And I felt like the Lord was telling me that that had also happened to my dad and to our people in our family. And so when I repented, what it actually was doing is the timeline that God had for my life, I got off on this way, and I'm the oldest kid. So as I got off, it took everybody else off. So my repentance was actually bringing us all back into godly order. And we are still in the midst of seeing all this. But out of that, that's where the teaching, the first fruits teaching, was opened up to Dad. God showed him, and he's talked about this, that he had an independent spirit. I don't need you, I don't need anyone. That's what we do when we're hurt and wounded and we're orphans. And so his repenting for that, all of a sudden it began to open the door and unlock House of Faith. So that now House of Faith can rise up and be the church it's supposed to be. Because it was also taken off course. So when you look at that, you see the exponential revelation that's been happening. It is incredible. This isn't about me. Okay? This isn't about me. I'm just telling you what God has done. So, back to my son, Spencer. He had to come clean because I was going there, that he was living with her. I knew that, but anyways. So we get up there, Sunday before Christmas, 23rd. I had been listening over and over to Robert Henderson to teaching, whatever the Lord would have me. And I would usually stop the autoplay because I would say, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to listen to? Well, that morning, I was getting ready, and I was busy, and I didn't pay attention, and it went on to the next person. Her name is Jeanette Strauss, and she started talking about the courtrooms in heaven. So the first thing I heard was, this is about my daughter who was running from God and was living with her boyfriend, and God gave me a dream. And my ears perk up a little bit. So she starts telling about her dream. And remarkably, it's very similar to a lot of my dreams. And I was like, whoa. And she said in her dream, it was more detailed. In her dream, she came face to face with the enemy. And he said, your daughter is a lawful captive. And to look up Isaiah 49:24-25. So when she said lawful captive, I went ding, ding, ding. Oh my gosh, my son's a lawful captive. Because he knowingly walked into this relationship, knowing that it was against God, and living with her. So I know we're 15 minutes behind, so I'm going to hurry. Anyway, it showed me how to pray. And because that morning, I had never prayed this way before, but I said, Holy Spirit, show me how to pray. And all that happened. And so I started taking that verse, and it says, shall the prey of the enemy and the lawful captive be delivered? Yes, I will contend with those who contend with you, and I will rescue your children. Isaiah 49:24-25. So I started praying that over him. That and Jeremiah 31, 15, 16, and 17, where it says, Rachel, quit weeping for your children. I will reward you for your grief work, and I will bring your children back from the land of the enemy. Some versions say, I will bring them home. I will bring them back to their borders. I will bring them to their foundation. And I'm like, that's me, God. So because I had those scriptures, I would say, Father, I've already repented, so I ask you to bring in remembrance my repentance. And I come to you on appeal, and I'm speaking these words. I've handed my son over to you. And so according to your scripture, this is what your word says. You are not a man that can lie, and you have to fulfill your word. And I send angels on behalf of your word to accomplish it. It took 32 days. And Spencer says, Mom, I'm moving back to Rome. God's been dealing with me. It took another 42 days for it to actually happen. But it did. And he's back there. Now he knows. He's repented to me. He said, I know I was wrong. And God has set me free. So I want that to happen for you guys. So I'm happy to share more. But I do want us to go ahead and stand. Whatever the Holy Spirit gave you, and again, I apologize for being late. So, I'm going to have you repeat after me here in just a minute, okay? So, Father, we come before you now, and we just thank you, God, for what you're accomplishing in our hearts. God, I thank you for open hearts, open minds, that you set us free, God. It's already been done on the cross. We just need to receive it and walk in it in the name of Jesus, so... So let's pray. So Heavenly Father, I come before the court of heaven. The enemy has accusations against me. And in my family line. want you to go ahead and just, whatever the Holy Spirit has revealed to you, let's take a couple minutes and you just say, I repent for this, and whatever God shows you, okay? This is an ongoing process, so more things may come. And as they do, do what we're doing and write them down. If you need help and want to talk to me, please do. So, Father, again, I bring all these things to you. And God, I repent. I'm sorry. I repent on behalf of myself. And down my bloodline, I repent on behalf of my mother, her mom and dad, all the way back to Adam and Eve. Anything that's come down the bloodline, I repent on behalf of my father, his mom and dad, and anything that's come down that bloodline. All the way back to Adam and Eve. Now, Father, I ask you to see me through the blood of Jesus, that his blood speaks that better word for me. I'm asking you, God, to render a verdict of not guilty any longer.
I ask you to open my book to record this repentance.
And I ask you, Holy Spirit,
to seal it
in the name of Jesus,
in the name of Jesus
and by the blood of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I ask you now, God,
to move me
from the courtroom of judgment to the throne room of grace and mercy, where you will continue to tear the veil off of my eyes, that I see and hear clearly your truth, and that I walk in your truth, and that you do this quickly, Lord. So, Father, I just thank you, Lord. I thank you, God, that you have received this. You have received our repentance, that Jesus' blood has covered it, that everything that he did on the cross, we nail these things to the cross, God. I thank you, God, that Holy Spirit, you will continue to reveal where the enemy has had legal right in my life, in our life, so that we can make things right and get things taken care of where the enemy cannot continue to kill, steal, and destroy me and my family line and our family line. I thank you, God, that you honor your word, that you are not a man that can lie. I thank you, God, that you will show me scriptures. And I urge you guys, I'm just going to say, I urge you to find scriptures to back up everything that you're praying for, and you begin to speak those over you and your children, your family line. Because that is your promise. Okay? So just like I told you in Isaiah 49, the promise. So I would say, Father, I come to you on appeal as I've already repented. I ask you to bring back into remembrance my previous repentance. I've given you this situation according to your word. And I'll just use as an example that Isaiah 49, I won't go through it, but you find your scripture. So, Father, you are not a man that can lie. You are faithful, and you will fulfill your word. and I send angels on assignment to accomplish your work.